Hi guys, this is Vaish from Vaishayas, and we are going to continue the chapter 14 of ancient history, that is Arash Sharma textbook. So this I have named it Mauryans too, because last chapter also was about Mauryans. We saw about Chandragupta Maurya, Chanakya, then Ashoka and the Kalinga war, and this time we are going to see the cultural significance, importance of Aryans, and then Mauryans, and what all are there in this particular chapter. One important thing about the test series, it is available, the PDFs, about 36 sets are there. It's a holistic coverage of the entire UPSC syllabus, so it will be a best practice for you in April and May month when you solve MCQs. Get MCQs from all the best sources which you know, not only mine, but mine. If you know the quality, please get it, because I want every serious aspirant to take benefit out of it. Okay, so description link will be there. Please check out that link and then order the test series. Now we'll continue this particular chapter. So the PDF you can download from Google, and the chapter name is Significance of the Maurya Rule. So state control, they're telling it first. Okay, the Brahminical law books, okay, that is the Dharma Shastras, again and again stress that the king should be guided by the laws laid down by it. Okay, that is the Dharma Shastra. According to that only the king should do all this activities, administration. Kautilya advises the king to promulgate Dharma when the social order based on the Varnas and Ashramas perishes. Okay, so when these kind of Varna system, everything and all is perishing, the king should promulgate Dharma. That is what Kautilya advised. Now the king is called Dharma Pravartaka, or promulgator of social order. So Dharma Pravartaka means the one who will promulgate social order in the society. That is Dharma Pravartaka. That the royal orders were superior to other orders was asserted by Ashoka in his inscriptions. Okay, so in his inscriptions also he told almost the same thing only. Royal order is superior to any other order. Ashoka promulgated Dharma and appointed officials to inculcate and enforce its essentials throughout the country. Assertions of royal absolutism was a natural culmination of the policy of military conquest adopted by the princes of Magadha, Anga, Vaisali, Kashi, Kosla, Avanti, Kalinga, etc. So these were all the kingdoms, famous kingdoms at that time. Okay, were annexed to the Magadhan Empire one by one. The military control were these over these areas eventually turned into coercive control of all aspects of life of the people. Okay, Magadha possessed the requisite power of sword to enforce its overall control. So overall, they are telling this Mauryan Empire becoming stronger and stronger, and the others were all subjudicating under this. In order to control all spheres of life, the state had to maintain a vast bureaucracy. In no other period of ancient history, we hear of so many officers as in the Mauryan times. Okay, so the bureaucracy was the most vast, you can tell, in the time of Mauryan Empire. The administrative mechanism was backed up by an elaborate system of espionage. Various types of spies collected intelligence about foreign enemies and kept an eye on numerous officers. They also held the collection of money from credulous people through deliberate resort to superstitious practices. Important functionaries called Tirthas, they were functionary of the offices. It seems that most functionaries were paid in cash. The highest functionaries were minister, that is Mantrin, high priest, that is Purohita, and commander-in-chief Senapati, crown princes Yuvaraja. Okay, it's very simple terms. So these were all different functionaries. They were paid generously, as much as 48,000 panas. Panna being a silver coin equal to 3/4 of a tola. Okay, these are all terminologies used in Mauryan time. Okay, panna is a silver coin and it is some 3/4 of a tola. Okay, that is how they measure. And these people were paid like that in cash. In sharp contrast to them, the lowest officers were given 60 panas. So if you see the difference, 48,000 panas for senior officers, just 60 panas consolidated pay to employees who had given as little, okay, selling 60 panas for some employees and then even lower as 10 or 20 panas. So you can imagine how difference it is in between the different levels of officers. Then economic regulations. If we rely on the Arthashastra of Kautilya, it would appear that the state appointed 27 superintendents, that is adhyakshas, one more term, okay, mostly to regulate the economic activities of the state. They controlled and regulated agriculture, trade, commerce, weights and measures, craft, that is meaning weaving, spinning, mining, everything. Okay, everything was controlled. So adhyakshas were the in charge of them. The state also provided irrigation facilities and regulated water supply for the benefit of agriculturalists. Megasthenes informs us that in the Mauryan Empire, the officer measured the land as in Egypt and inspected the channels through which water was distributed into. okay, into smaller channels. So Megasthenes and Kautilya both are giving lot of information about how the polity or the administration happened and how irrigation facilities were provided to the farmers. If you believe the Arthashastra of Kautilya, a striking social development of the Mauryan period was the employment of slaves in agricultural operations. Okay, earlier in Vedic time, you know, the slaves and all were mainly used for domestic purposes, but now they are more in use for agricultural operations because they need lot of farming to happen and lot of taxes can be collected. Okay, 1/4 to 1/6 of the tax. Megasthenes states that he did not notice any slaves in India. Okay. But there is no doubt that domestic slaves were found in India from Vedic times onwards. For the first time in the Mauryan period, slaves were engaged in agricultural work on a large scale. The state maintained farms on which numerous slaves and hired laborers were employed. 150,000 war captivities brought by Ashoka from Kalinga may have been engaged in agricultural activity. So, you know, Kalinga war I explained in the last video. So, whoever were the prisoners of war kind of thing, whoever were captured and brought back to his place were used in agriculture. Okay, slaves, laborers, that kind of thing. But ancient Indian society was not a slave society. When the slaves did in, what the slaves did in Greece and Rome was done by the Shudras in India. Okay, so the slave system is different in both the countries. Okay, like in Greek, Rome and all, it is the slaves who do all these kind of things. But in India, it is the Shudras who do all these kind of things, the slave related things, serving the other classes. The Shudras were regarded as the collective property of the three higher Varnas. They were compelled to serve them as slaves, artisans, agriculture, laborers and domestic servants. Several reasons suggest that the royal control worked over a very large area, at least in the core of the empire. This was because of the strategic position of Pataliputra, from where royal agents could sail up and down in the four directions. I already told you, I think four rivers were there: Ganga, Gandak, Son and Sarayu. Okay, GGSS, that four rivers were there in four directions, and so people could move easily into different directions. And the royal road ran from Pataliputra to Nepal through Vaisali and Champaran. Okay, so they had this royal road also. We also hear of the road at the foothills of the Himalayas. It passed from Vaisali through Champaran to Kapilavastu. No need to buy out all these things, but they had lot of water transport and the road transport. Okay, that's the only thing you need to know. Connectivity up to Andhra and Karnataka also. Further, it seems that the Mauryan rulers did not have to deal with large population. 650,000 men, 10% of population. It's not required. Ashokan inscriptions show that royal writ ran all over the country except the extreme east and south, but rigid state control may not have proved effective much beyond the middle Gangetic zone. So although they are telling all these things, like officers were there, adhyakshas were there, everything was there, it is telling it could not have the efficient control could not have gone beyond the Gangetic zone, middle Gangetic zone. Okay, so just concluding whatever they discussed in this whole 1 or 2 pages, they are telling like that. The Mauryan period constitutes a landmark in system of taxation in ancient India. Kautilya names many taxes to be collected from peasants, artisans and traders. This required a strong and efficient machinery for assessment, collection and storage. The Mauryans attached greater importance to assessment than to storage and depositing. Okay. So collection of taxes was a huge thing and it was a very important thing in that time. The Samarthas was the highest officer in charge of assessment, and the Sannidatta was the chief custodian of the state treasury and storehouse. So this UPSC will definitely pick up, so you should know. Samartha was the one who was in charge of assessment, okay, taxes, assessment, and the custodian was Sannidatta. Okay. I think it's there in our MCQ PDF also, try to get the test series. The harm done to the state by the first is thought to be more serious than the harm caused by the second. Okay, so assessment is more important, they are telling, rather than custodian. In fact, an elaborate machinery for assessment first appears in the Mauryan period. The list of taxes mentioned in the Arthashastra is impressive, and if these were really collected, very little would be left to the people to live on. So they are telling it was very harsh kind of taxation system as per Arthashastra. We have epigraphic evidence for the existence of rural storehouses, which shows that taxes were collected in kind, and these granaries were meant for helping local people in the times of famine and drought. So collection of taxes were there in the form of kind, and it was stored in rural storehouses, and in the time of famine and drought it will be used. It seems that the punch marked silver coins, which carry the symbols of the peacock and the hill and crescent, formed the imperial currency of the Mauryans. So this is also one important statement. What all symbols are there on the Mauryan coin? Okay, the royal coin had symbol of peacock, hill and crescent. Okay, peacock, hill, crescent. They have been discovered in large numbers. Apparently, they contributed to the collection of taxes and payment of officers in cash. Further, because of its uniformity, the currency must have facilitated market exchange in a wider area. The Mauryans made a remarkable contribution to the art and architecture. They introduced stone masonry on a wide scale. The Megasthenes states that the Mauryan palace at Pataliputra was as splendid as the capital of Iran. Okay. This is Ashoka pillar, okay, one of the Ashoka pillar. Fragments of stone pillars and stumps indicating the existence of an 80-pillared hall has been discovered at Kumrar on the outskirts of modern Patna. Okay, they are telling about an 80-pillared hall which is there in the outskirts of Patna. Although these remains do not recall the magnificence mentioned by Megasthenes, they certainly attest the high technical skill attained by the Mauryan artisans in polishing the stone pillars, which are shining as northern black polished ware. Okay, we have already seen northern black polished ware in the Buddha age. So this Ashokan time also polished stone was used for pillars. It must have been difficult task to carry the huge blocks of stone from the quarries and to polish and embellish them when they were placed erect. All this seems to be great feat of engineering, because this huge stones, high pillars had to be carried and then polished also before erecting. It is considered as a very high feat of engineering. Each pillar is made up of a single piece of sandstone. Okay, this pillar you see, it's a single piece of sandstone. Only their capitals, which contain beautiful sculptures in the form of lions or bulls, are joined with the pillar on the top. These polished pillars were set up throughout the country, which shows, actually this picture, if you see, this is the bull capital. Okay, it will be erected above the pillar. Okay, if you see here, this is the above the pillar. So that is the only separate part remaining. This whole thing is a single sandstone, they are telling. It's not like small rocks are joined together. So that is why it's an engineering feat. So technical knowledge involved in their polishing and transport has spread far and wide. The Mauryan artisans also started the practice of hewing out caves from rocks for monks to live in. So for cave residential places were there for monks to live. The earliest examples are the Barabar caves at a distance of 30 km from Gaya. Okay, later this kind of cave architecture spread to western and southern India also. So it was spreading across India, these pillars or the cave architecture, all those things. Spread of material culture. On the one hand, the Mauryans created for the first time a well-organized state machinery which operated at the heart of the empire. On the other hand, their conquest opened the door for trading and missionary activities. Okay, it seems that the contacts established by administrators, traders and Jaina and Buddhist monks led to the spread of the material culture of the Gangetic basin to the areas situated on the periphery of the empire. So they are telling, because of that interaction which they had between everyone, administrators, traders, Jainas, Buddhist monks and all, the material culture was being spread across the land. Okay, not only in the nearby areas but in outside the periphery also. So the new material culture in the Gangetic basin was based on an intensive use of iron, plenty of punchmarked coins, abundance of beautiful pottery called the northern black polished ware, introduction of burnt bricks and ring wells, and above all on the rise of towns in the northeastern India. So it's like a good society. Everything is good, like the coins or the pottery, the pillars, the ring wells, irrigation, burnt bricks, everything is there. Okay, town life. A Greek writer called Arrian, okay, it's a Greek writer, states that it is not possible to record with accuracy the number of cities. This picture is again a terracotta figurine of the Mauryan period. Okay, terracotta figure, like Mother Goddess in Harappan time, we saw similar kind of thing. So cities on account of their multiplicity. Thus the Mauryan period witnessed rapid development of material culture in the Gangetic basin. On account of easy access to the rich iron ores of southern Bihar, people used more and more of iron implements. To this period belong socketed axes, sickles and possibly plowshare. Okay, so iron implements are used in bulk. Although arms and weapons were the monopoly of the Mauryan state, the use of other iron tools were not restricted to any class. Their use and manufacture must have spread from the Gangetic basin to the distant parts of the empire. Okay, so arms, you know, it was the monopoly of the kingdom, but still that was only for iron tools. The other things and all other people were using. In the Mauryan period, burnt bricks are used for the first time in northeastern India. Okay, so that's also a fact. In northeastern India, burnt bricks were first time used in the time of Mauryans. The Mauryan structure made up of burnt bricks have been found in Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. Houses are made of both bricks and timber, which was available in plenty because of thick vegetation in ancient times. Megasthenes speaks of the wooden structures at the Mauryan capital Pataliputra. Excavation shows that the logs of wood were also used as an important line of defense against flood and foreign invasions. Okay, so they had this wooden kind of logs of wood which was placed, or structures were there, which will protect them from foreign invasions and also floods. The use of burnt bricks spread in the outlying provinces of the empire. Because of the moist climate and heavy rainfall, it was not possible to have lasting and large structures made up of mud or mud bricks as we find in the dry zones. Okay, so because it's moist climate, they cannot use mud structures. That is what they are telling. Therefore, the diffusion in the use of burnt bricks proved to be a great boon. Eventually, it led to the flowering of towns in the different parts of the empire. Similarly, the ring wells, which appeared first under the Mauryans in the Gangetic Basin, spread beyond the heart of the empire. Since ring wells could supply water to people for domestic use, it was not imperative now to found settlements on the banks of the river. They also served as a stockage pits in congested settlements. Okay, so now different types of irrigation systems are there, so people need not just settle in the banks of the river. They can settle anywhere because the irrigation models have been implemented and Mauryans are providing it to the people. The elements of the Middle Gangetic material culture seem to have transferred with modifications to Northern Bengal, Kalinga, Andhra and Karnataka. In Bangladesh, where we find the Mahasthana inscription, okay, you should know this, Mahasthana inscription in Bogra, that is in Bangladesh. One district name also given. We find NBP at Bangar in Dinjapur district. Okay, so in Bangladesh inscription, it is mentioning about this pottery thing. Okay, and this is actually Lomarshi cave. Okay, it's a cave in Barabar Hills. Okay, Lomarshi cave, Barabar Hills at that time. Then NBP sherds have been found at some places, such as again Chandrakotugar in the 24 Paragnas in West Bengal. Okay, so Bangladesh, West Bengal region, they are telling lot of NBP pottery was found. In Orissa also. Then these settlements were ascribed to Mauryan times in the 3rd century BC and they contained NBP and iron implements and punchmark coins. Since Sisupalgar is situated near Dhauli and Jagonda, no need to remember any of these names. Okay, it's very tough. Nobody can remember this. Okay, where Ashokan inscriptions have been found on the ancient highway passing along the eastern coast of India. Material culture may have reached this area as a result of contact with Magadha. So they're telling just the spread. Okay, Ashokan inscriptions were there here and there. So the culture was spreading, materials were spreading, everything was spreading far and wide. This contact may have started in the 4th century BC when the Nandas are said to have conquered Kalinga, but it deepened under the conquest of Kalinga in the 3rd century BC. Possibly as a measure of pacification after the Kalinga war, Ashoka promoted some settlements in Orissa which had been incorporated into his empire. So they are telling like the relation with Kalinga and Orissa and all started at the time of Nandas, Nanda dynasty. Mahapadma Nanda was the ruler. But when Ashoka attacked Kalinga and then after that war he was having sentiments for them and allowed settlements and all, that is when it actually flourished or it actually expanded the connections. Although we find iron weapons and implements at several places in Andhra and Karnataka in the Mauryan period, the advance of iron technology was the contribution of the megalith builders, who are noted for various kinds of large stone burials, including those of a round form. But some of these places have Ashokan inscriptions as well as NBP, etc., belonging to the 3rd century BC. For example, a few inscriptions of Mauryan times have been found at Amaravati, and Ashokan inscriptions have been found at Eragudi in Andhra and at several places in Karnataka. So it's telling it's Ashokan inscriptions is one of the main reasons for the spread of culture. Okay, and here I think they mentioned about the megalith and burials. Okay, I just want to tell you that it is already covered in the NCRT class 6th and 7th NCRTs. Please go and watch that. You will get a detailed information about Neolithic, Paleolithic, Megalithic sites and all. Now, let's continue. It therefore appears that from the eastern coast, ingredients of the material culture percolated through Maurya contacts into the lower Deccan Plateau. The art of making steel may have spread through Mauryan contacts in some parts of the country. Steel objects belonging to about 200 BC or to an earlier date have been found in the Middle Gangetic Basin. The spread of steel may have led to the use of better methods of cultivation in Kalinga and created conditions for the rise of the Cheti kingdom in that region. So one kingdom was there, so they are telling the trade was there, steel, spread of steel was there, all these kind of things have led to the rise of such a kingdom, okay, in that region below Kalinga. Now in some ways the Satavahana's empire was a projection of the Mauryan empire in the Deccan. Okay, the Satavahana rulers adopted some of the administrative units of the Mauryans, and in their times Buddhism flourished in the same manner as it did in the heart of the empire of Ashoka. So any other important kingdom, if you want to know which were working on lines of the Mauryan empire, it is Satavahanas. Okay, they also spread Buddhism to a large extent. You should know Satavahana kingdom, it is little bit in the south, not near the Gangetic region. The existence of inscriptions, occasional NBP, pottery and punchmark coins in parts of Bangladesh, Orissa, Andhra and Karnataka from near 300 BC shows that Mauryan period attempts were made to spread elements of the Middle Gangetic Basin culture in the distant area. The process seems to be in accord with the instructions of Kautilya. Kautilya advised that new settlements should be founded with the help of cultivators who were apparently Vaishyas, and with that of Shudra laborers who should be drafted from the overpopulated areas. In order to bring the virgin soil under cultivation, the new peasants were allowed remission in taxes, okay, and supplied with cattle, seeds and money. All these were provided to bring the new soil under cultivation. The state followed this policy in the hope that it would kept back what it had given. Such settlements were necessary in those areas where people were not acquainted with the use of iron plowshare. Okay, the policy led to the opening of large areas to cultivation and settlement. How far the Mauryan towns facilitated the diffusion of material culture of the Gangetic basin into the tribal belt of central India, extending from Chota Nagpur. I don't think we have to go line by line like this. It is not required because I'm not finding any factual information here. Okay, and here Dharma Mahamantras, I told you already, Matras. Okay, it is actually the officers appointed to spread Dharma across all the regions. Ashoka launched a deliberate and systematic policy of acculturation. It's not required. Actually, this can be a mains question, or other than if they ask detailed thing in history, optional. Other than that, we don't need anything from here. Okay, this thing we already seen. Like, he claims that hunters and fishermen stopped hunting and fishing and all after following Dharma. Causes of the fall of Mauryan Empire. The Mauryan Empire, which had been ruled by successive wars culminating in the conquest of Kalinga, began to disintegrate after the exit of Ashoka in 232 BC. Several causes seem to have brought under the decline and fall of the Mauryan Empire. So Brahminical reaction was one reason. You know, like, Buddhism is being promoted this much, obviously Brahmanas won't like it, right? So that is why Brahmana reaction is one of the most important reason. Even the next kingdom which comes after Maurya will be dominated by Brahmanas. We'll see. The Brahminical reaction began as a result of the policy of Ashoka. There is no doubt that Ashoka adopted a tolerant policy and asked the people to respect even the Brahmanas. But he prohibited killing of animals and birds and decided superfluous rituals performed by women. This naturally affected the income of the Brahmanas. Okay, so the rituals were stopped, so obviously Brahmanas were not liking it. The anti-sacrifice attitude of Buddhism and of Ashoka naturally brought much loss to the Brahmanas, who lived on the gift made to them in various kinds of sacrifices. Hence, in spite of the tolerant policy of Ashoka, the Brahmanas developed some kind of antipathy to him. Obviously, they were not satisfied with his tolerant policy. They really wanted a policy that should favor them and uphold the existing interest and privileges. Some of the new kingdoms which arose in the ruins of the Mauryan Empire were ruled by the Brahmanas, the Sungas and the Kanvas, who ruled in Madhya Pradesh and further east on the remnants of Mauryan Empire. Okay, all these were Brahmanas, the Sungas or Kanvas, whoever came, okay, after this Mauryan decline. These are all Brahmana kingdoms. Similarly, Satavahanas, who founded a lasting kingdom in the western Deccan and Andhra, claimed to be Brahmanas. Okay, that also I told you, they were following some things from Mauryans, but they were also Brahmanas. These Brahmana dynasties performed the Vedic sacrifices, which were neglected by Ashoka. Okay, financial crisis is the second reason. The enormous expenditure on the army and payment to bureaucracy created a financial crisis for the Mauryan Empire. As far as we know, the ancient times, the Mauryans maintained the largest army and the largest regiment of officers. Despite all kinds of taxes imposed on the people, it was difficult to maintain this huge superstructure. It seems that Ashoka made large grants to the Buddhist monk, which left the royal treasury empty. In order to meet expenses in the last days, they had to melt the images made of gold. Then oppressive rule. Oppressive rule in the provinces was an important cause of the breakup of the empire. In the reign of the Bindusara, that is the father of Ashoka, the citizens of Taxila bitterly complained against the misrule of wicked bureaucrats. Okay, Dushtamatyas. Okay, Amatyas we saw were officers, so Dushtamatyas are wicked bureaucrats. So oppressive rule was there. We saw Brahmana's reason, financial reason, and now oppressive rule of these kind of bureaucracy. Their grievance was readdressed by the appointment of Ashoka. But when Ashoka became emperor, a similar complaint was lodged by the same city. Okay, the Kalinga edict shows that the Ashoka felt very much concerned about oppression in the provinces and therefore asked the Mahamantras not to torture townsmen without due cause. Okay, so people should be handled with care and they should be administered well. That is what Ashoka tried to do. For this purpose, he introduced rotation of officers in Tosal, that's a place in Kalinga, Ujjain and Takshila. Okay, so rotation of officers, whether it's because if one person is there ruling in the same province for long number of years, it will be like they will become obviously corrupt. Okay, that is why rotation of officers came. He himself spent 256 nights on a pilgrimage tour, which may have helped the administrative supervisions, but all this failed to stop oppression in the outlying provinces. And after his retirement, Takshila took the earliest opportunity to throw off the imperial yoke. Now, spread of the new material knowledge in the outlying areas. We have seen how Magadha owned its expansion to certain basic material advantages. Once the knowledge of the use of these elements of culture spread to central India, the Deccan and the Kalinga, as a result of the expansion of the Magadhan Empire, the Gangetic Basin, which formed the heart of the empire, lost its special advantage. The regular use of iron tools and weapons in the peripheral provinces coincided with the decline and fall of Mauryan Empire. Okay, so this iron tools in this much thing was this much a huge number. Actually began and ended at the time in the same time. Okay, Mauryan Empire ended, then this usage also ended. On the basis of material culture acquired from the Magadha, new kingdoms could be founded and developed. This explains the rise of Sungas, Kanvas in central India, the Chettis in Kalinga, and that of Satavahanas in the Deccan. So four kingdoms, okay, Sungas, Kanvas, Chettis, and Satavahanas. These were all rising kingdoms after the Mauryan Empire. Neglect of the northwest front province of the Great Wall of China. Okay, so these regions, the northwest frontier, that's in the Afghanistan Pakistan region, and also the Great Wall of China, these places were neglected by Ashoka. Since Ashoka was mostly preoccupied with missionary activities at home and abroad, he could not pay attention to the safeguarding of the passage of the northwestern frontier. This had become necessary in the view of movement of tribes in Central Asia in the 3rd century BC. The Scythians, we'll deal in the next chapter. Okay, the Scythians were in the state of constant flux. A nomadic people, mainly relying on the use of horse, they posed serious dangers to the settled empires in China and India. The Chinese ruler Shi Huangxi constructed the Great Wall of China at this time. Okay, 247-210 BC is the time when Great Wall of China was built, and to shield his empire against the attack of the Scythians. So they were taking care of this other external thing, but nothing was done by Ashoka. That is the difference they are telling. Great Wall of China was built to protect from Scythians by China, but in India, Ashoka did not do anything. Naturally, Scythians made a push forward to India. They forced the Parthians, the Sakas, the Greeks to move towards India. Greeks had set up a kingdom in the north. Afghanistan, which was known as Bactria. Okay, this Bactria, Scythia and all, don't worry, we will detail you do in the next chapter. This was followed by a series of invasion which continued till the beginning of the Christian era. The Mauryan Empire was finally destroyed by Pushyamitra Shunga. This is the most important name you should know. Okay, Pushyamitra Shunga in 185 BC. Although a Brahmana, he was a general of the last Mauryan king called Brihadratha. So Brihadratha was the last Mauryan king, and his general was Pushyamitra Shunga, who was a Brahman, and he just overthrew this kingdom because Brahmanas did not like the Mauryan rule. He is said to have killed Brihadratha in public and forcibly usurped the throne of Pataliputra. The Shungas ruled in Pataliputra and central India, and they performed several Vedic sacrifices in order to mark the revival of the Brahminical way of life. So that is how Buddhism was overthrown and Mauryan Empire was overthrown, and Brahminical way of life was retained. Okay, Pushyamitra Shunga, Shunga dynasty. It is said that they persecuted the Buddhists. They were succeeded by the Kanvas, who were also Brahmanas. So that is about the story of Mauryans declining. Now some questions I will show you. Not specifically related to this chapter, but it will be important for you, and picked up from our ancient history PDF. Who was the last ruler of Mauryan Empire? Very simple question. I just now explained. Try to answer in comment section. Next question. Which of the following mural paintings are matched correctly? Okay, it's actually art and culture plus ancient history. So you have to tell me which is matched correctly. So is it 1 and 2, 1 and 3, 1, 2 and 3, or 3 only? Okay, Varli, Mumbai, Pithora, Rajasthan, Mithila, Bihar. UPSC have asked 1000 times about these kind of questions, these kind of topics, so please try to answer it, okay? Next question. With respect to Mauryan architecture, what is Lomas Rishi? I showed you a picture also of this, so try to answer whether it's another name for Sarnath land capital, another name for Sanchi Stupa, a rock cut cave architecture at Barabar Gaya, an elephant structure in Dhauli, Orissa. So try to answer this, and the test series link is given in the description. Please click on that link and then contact me. I'll help you clear this prelims 2018, okay, easily. So let's record the next video soon. Till then, enjoy your learning. Thank you and have a nice day.